Hello and welcome to this new edition of News Today. Without delay, let's have a look at the headlines first. Ratna Bhandar, the sacred treasury of Sri Jagannath Temple, Puri, reopened after 46 years. World Bank Group Guarantee Platform goes live for business. The Reserve Bank of India revises rules to manage financial fraud. Report of India's G20 Task Force on Digital Public Infrastructure released. India's Energy Storage Landscape report released by Mercom India Research. Navigating New Horizons, a foresight report released by UNEP. In our first news, let's delve into a significant cultural report from Odisha, where the sacred treasury of Sri Jagannath Temple in Puri, known as Ratna Bhandar, has been reopened after 46 years. This historic event was overseen by a high-level committee established by the Odisha government and led by retired Justice Bishwanath Rath. The committee was tasked with supervising the inventory of valuables, including jewellery stored in the Ratna Bhandar. Additionally, the Magji Laddu, a cherished prasad from Odisha's Dhinkanal district and one of the Chappan Bhog offerings at Sri Jagannath Temple, has been awarded a geographical indication tag, recognizing its unique cultural and regional significance. So what is Ratna Bhandar? The sacred treasury located on the northern side of Jagmohan, the assembly hall of the temple, comprises of two chambers, Bahar Bhandar, that is the outer chamber, and Bhitar Bhandar, that is the inner chamber. These chambers contain the precious jewels of the three sibling deities, Lord Balabhadra, Lord Jagannath, and Devi Subhadra. Sri Jagannath Temple, also known as the White Pagoda, is dedicated to Lord Jagannath, an incarnation of Lord Vishnu, his sister Devi Subhadra, and elder brother Lord Balabhadra, forming the Holy Trinity. The temple was built during the rule of Anantavarman Chodgangadev, the founder of the Ganga dynasty in the first part of the 12th century AD. The architectural style of Sri Jagannath Temple is a splendid example of Kalinga architecture, consisting of four main parts. The Viman or Deul, that is Garbhagriha, built in the Naga style, characterized by a curvilinear tower known as Shikhar. The Jagmohan, formed in the Pidha Deul style, where the Shikhar has tiers of diminishing Pidhas or platforms. The Nat Mandap, the audience or dancing hall, and the Bhog Mandap, the hall for residuary offerings. The outer walls of the main temples are adorned with figures of Vishnu with four on each side, depicting 24 forms of Vishnu such as Keshav, Madhav, Damodar and Narayan. In conclusion, the reopening of the Ratna Bhandar is a momentous occasion reflecting the temple's rich heritage and cultural significance. In our next news, the World Bank Group Guarantee Platform has officially gone live for business. Initiated in the year 2024, this new platform consolidates all guarantee products and exports from across the World Bank Group institutions at the Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency. The WBG guarantees are primarily provided to private lenders for infrastructure financing, especially in situations where the demand for debt funding is substantial, political and sovereign risks are significant, and long-dated financing is critical to a project's viability. Before the launch of this platform, the World Bank Group offered 20 different guarantee solutions, each with its own processes, rules and standards which often impeded clients' access. The World Bank Group Guarantee Platform aims to boost the World Bank Group's annual guarantee issuance to $20 billion by the year 2030. In 2024 alone, the World Bank Group issued approximately $10.3 billion in new guarantees using products from the platform. The platform offers three types of coverage: credit guarantees for loans to the public or private sector, trade finance guarantees, and political risk insurance against non-commercial risk for private sector projects or public-private partnerships. Let us also take a look at the significance of the World Bank Group Guarantee Platform. It offers a simplified, market-friendly menu of guarantee options, providing multiple choices to World Bank clients. The platform streamlines processes, removes redundancies, and enhances accessibility by de-risking investment in developing countries. By prioritizing high-impact projects, it facilitates growth, drives sustainable development, and promotes inclusive growth through innovative financing. Lastly, let's also take a look at what is the World Bank Group. It is a global partnership of five institutions, of which India is a part of the first four. These institutions include the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, the International Development Association, the International Finance Corporation, the Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency, and the International Center for Settlement of Investment Disputes. The IBRD and IDA together form the World Bank. Moving ahead, In a major development, the Reserve Bank of India has revised the rules to manage financial fraud by issuing three new master directions on fraud risk management for regulated entities. If we talk about the regulated entities under the RBI, it includes commercial banks, including regional rural banks and all India financial institutions, cooperative banks, that is urban cooperative banks, state cooperative banks and central cooperative banks, and non-banking finance companies, including housing finance companies. The new master directions encompass several critical aspects. Firstly, in compliance with the Supreme Court judgment in State Bank of India and others versus Rajesh Agarwal and others of 2023, regulated entities are required to ensure compliance with the principles of natural justice in a time-bound manner before classifying persons or entities as fraud. Furthermore, the RBI mandates the establishment of a data analytics and market intelligence unit to strengthen risk management systems within these entities. The framework on early warning signals and red flagging of accounts has been reinforced for the early detection and prevention of frauds. This framework also mandates timely reporting to law enforcement agencies and supervisors, ensuring swift action against fraudulent activities. The significance of these new directions is multifaceted. Firstly, they reduce and rationalize the compliance burden on the regulated entities as the existing 36 circulars were withdrawn. Additionally, these directions institute a robust internal audit and controls framework within the regulated entities. Importantly, these revised rules extend to regional rural banks, rural cooperative banks, and housing finance companies, thereby enhancing fraud risk management across a broader spectrum of financial institutions. In summary, the Reserve Bank of India's revised master directions on fraud risk management represent a significant stride towards a more secure and resilient financial system. In our next news, we cover a landmark report released by India's G20 Task Force on Digital Public Infrastructure established in 2023 under India's G20 presidency. This task force was created to facilitate priorities on DPI and financial inclusion and to support global adoption of DPI. Digital public infrastructure refers to essential platforms such as digital identity systems, financial infrastructure, and data exchange solutions. These building blocks empower governments to enhance lives through digital inclusion. India's own DPI, known as India Stack, is composed of three foundational layers: digital identification through Aadhaar, real-time fast payments via UPI, and a secure platform for sharing personal data without compromising privacy. India's achievements in this domain are remarkable. The Unified Payments Interface, or UPI, processes over 10 billion transactions each month. DigiLocker, another component, securely stores over 6 billion documents for 211 million people. The divide between the rich and the poor in bank account ownership has dramatically decreased from 14% to just 1% between 2011 and 2022. The significance of these advancements is profound. DPI empowers individuals by giving them control over their money and data, spurs market innovation by reducing transaction cost, maintains competition through interoperability, and attracts private capital. Moreover, it enables vulnerable groups such as physically remote populations and women to access essential services, thereby helping to close intergroup disparities, including gender gaps. Notably, the gender gap in bank account ownership has been reduced from 18% to almost 0% between 2011 and 2022. Wrapping up, the report outlines five major categories of DPI that are transforming various sectors. These categories are verifiable identity and registries, data sharing, credentials and models, signatures and consent, discovery and fulfillment, and payments. Let's talk about them in detail. The verifiable identity and registries involves verifying identities and accessing profile data of individuals, entities, and objects, enabling secure ID authentication and eKYC processes. Next, data sharing, credentials, and models category focuses on the sharing of data, including history, profile, and attributes, either peer-to-peer or publicly, ensuring that personal data is shared with consent. The signature and consent ensures that data and agreements are tamper-proof and non-repudiable with necessary permissions from the source. Discovery and fulfillment enables the access of goods and services through open protocols and APIs, facilitating processes such as business registration and tax filing. Lastly, the payments category simplifies financial transactions covering P2P, P2M, B2B, and G2P social benefit transfers, ensuring ease of financial dealings across various sectors. In conclusion, the report from India's G20 Task Force on DPI highlights the transformative power of digital infrastructure in promoting financial inclusion and innovation. Moving ahead, let's delve into a newly released report by Mercom India Research titled India's Energy Storage Landscape, which sheds light on the significant progress and challenges in India's battery energy storage sector as of March 2024. The report highlights that India's cumulative installed battery energy storage system capacity has reached an impressive 219.1 MWh. Notably, Chhattisgarh leads the way, accounting for 54.8% of this cumulative capacity. Solar photovoltaic systems, when combined with BESS, contribute to 90.6% of the total installed capacity. So what exactly is BESS? A battery energy storage system is an electrochemical device designed to store energy from renewable sources like solar and wind, releasing it when needed. Various types of batteries are used in BESS, including lithium-ion batteries, lead-acid batteries, and sodium-sulfur batteries. The significance of BESS in India's energy landscape cannot be overstated. These systems play a crucial role in minimizing greenhouse gas emissions, aiding India in achieving its Panchamrit target of net zero emissions by 2070. Additionally, BESS helps reduce energy cost by storing energy that can be used during peak hours when energy prices are the highest. They also reduce grid dependency and improve grid stability by balancing supply and demand. However, the journey is not without its challenges. BESS requires increased maintenance and monitoring, and the initial cost can be high, potentially deterring investment. Moreover, the extraction of raw materials like lithium is energy intensive and can lead to environmental issues such as water pollution and land degradation. Recognizing these challenges, the Indian government has taken several initiatives to promote BESS. These include the Viability Gap Funding Scheme aimed at developing 4,000 MWh of BESS projects by 2030-31, and the waiver of interstate transmission charges on BESS projects commissioned up to June 2025. The Production Linked Incentive Scheme for the National Programme on Advanced Chemistry Cell Battery Storage is another key initiative, alongside the National Framework for Promoting Energy Storage Systems by the Ministry of Power. In conclusion, while India's energy storage landscape shows promising growth, continued efforts and strategic initiatives are essential to overcome the associated challenges. Ahead in the news, let's dive into a pivotal report released by the United Nations Environment Programme titled Navigating New Horizons, a Foresight Report. The report brings to light several critical global shifts that are exacerbating what is known as the triple planetary crisis: pollution, biodiversity loss, and climate change. It underscores the concept of a global polycrisis where multiple shocks such as wars, extreme weather events, and pandemics are interconnected, largely due to the intricate web of globalization. Key findings from the report reveal that our relationship with the environment is changing dramatically. We are witnessing a rise in antimicrobial resistance and an increase in uninhabitable spaces due to climate change. Additionally, the scarcity and competition for critical resources such as orbital space are reshaping global security dynamics. The digital landscape is also experiencing waves of innovation with the Internet of Things and AI adoption at the forefront. However, this technological advancement comes with its own set of challenges, including the amplified risks associated with autonomous and artificial intelligence weapon systems and the misuse of biological agents. The report also highlights the growing issue of mass forced displacement, with 1.5% of the world's population currently displaced. Furthermore, it brings attention to the rising levels of eco-anxiety, negative emotional responses linked to environmental and climate crisis. In terms of recommendations, the report calls for a new social contract as advocated by the UN Secretary General in his Our Common Agenda report. This involves engaging diverse stakeholders, including women, indigenous communities, and young people. It also emphasizes the need for agile and adaptive governance supported by technology and funding to steer us towards a sustainable future. Additionally, it stresses the importance of guiding governance through data and knowledge. In conclusion, the UNEP's Navigating New Horizons report serves as a stark reminder of the intertwined challenges we face and the urgent need for a collaborative, informed approach to governance. The personality in news for today is Maharishi Sushrut. He is induced as the All India Institute of Ayurveda organized the second national seminar, Saushrutam Shailya Sangoshti, on the occasion of Sushrut Jayanti 2024, that is on 15th July. He was an ancient physician from Kashi, today known as Varanasi, also known as the father of Indian medicine and father of surgery. Talking about his key contributions, he was the author of Sushrut Samhita, written in Sanskrit, which is one of the great trilogy of Ayurvedic medicine, others being Charak Samhita by Maharishi Charak and Ashtang Hriday by Vaghbhat. It covers extensively about pathology, anatomy and surgical management, along with treatment of 12 varieties of fracture, 6 types of dislocation, skin grafting, rhinoplasty, which is a technique used to reconstruct nose. Through his actions, he exemplified the values of courage, hard work, composure, proficiency, and dedication. As we conclude today's main news, let's have a look at some quick updates. Supreme Court stated that the state can't alter the scheduled caste list published under Article 341. The court struck down the Bihar government resolution to merge economically backward class community in SC list. In Article 341, the President can officially designate certain groups as scheduled castes for specific states or union territories. The Ministry of Civil Aviation has announced the implementation of a Uniform Integrated Goods and Services Tax rate of 5% on all aircraft and aircraft engine parts. It is significant as it boosts domestic maintenance, repair and overhaul industry, among others. Biotechnology Research and Innovation Council, Translational Health Science and Technology Institute hosted an industry meet, SYNCHN 2024. Synergy in science built through elements of collaboration for high quality data and expertise in NCR Biotech Cluster. Talking about BRIC, it has been created as a registered society by Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology by subsuming various autonomous institutions. A pilot project by Central Institute for Cotton Research, Indian Council of Agricultural Research or ICAR, deploys AI-powered pheromone traps to protect cotton crops from pink bollworm pest infestation. The pheromone traps uses chemical signals or pheromones emitted by female moth to attract mate, hence catches only males of that species. MVC Change, that is world's first commercial passenger ferry powered by 100% zero-emission hydrogen fuel cells, was launched in San Francisco. It can travel about 300 nautical miles and operate for 16 hours before needing to refuel. As per IUCN, the Indian leopard is suspected to have declined by 24.5% over the last three generations. The Indian leopard's habitat distribution consists of India, Nepal, Bhutan, and parts of Pakistan, excluding mangrove forests and deserts. Inland Waterways Authority of India and Transport Department of Government of Nagaland to conduct detailed feasibility study for development of Tizu and Zumki River, that is National Waterways 101. Tizu originates near Longkhim, Tunsang district of Nagaland and falls into Chinwin River, also known as Ningthi River in Myanmar. 2024 marks the 100th year of electroencephalography or EEG. EEG is a medical test which measures brain electrical activity generated by neurons. Before we sign off, let's challenge your understanding in today's installment of Test Your Knowledge. Thank you for joining us. We hope you found this episode of News Today engaging. For the solution to today's quiz and to access the PDF version of News Today, remember to visit the provided links in the description below.